Okay. Okay, we left off pay out from the dollars. The Mishnah says that two men are permitted to seclude themselves with one woman. Why? Because Yichud, the reason why one is not permitted to seclude themselves with a woman who's not permitted to them, because there's a chance that in that setting he may have relations with her, cohabit with her. So it's but since two men with a woman is not a concern, because one man is not going to cohabit in the presence of the other man. So therefore, there's no prohibition of Yichud. So Amar Rav Yehuda Rav Moshe El Abir. That's only if they're within the city. Aval Bederech, if they're traveling, or they're out of the city. Adju Shlosha, you need three men. Why? Shem Yitzdorcha Echad Mehen Lahashkin, let's say you have two men with a woman. Let's say one person has to urinate, and he has to go off at a distance to urinate. V'nimtza Echad Misyachni Me'ervo. So the one who remains, it's only him and the woman. So it's no different than one man and a woman. There's a provision of Yichud. So therefore, if you're on the way, you have to have three men. So even if one should go off to urinate, which was bodily function, she's still what? She's in the presence of two men. So therefore, there's no concern that one may cohabit with her because the other one is present. I was waiting for that question. Okay. Now I know why the British can never get along with the French. Okay. Okay, we're fourth line on Pei Aleph. Name him Sayale. We're going to be proof to this, that if you're traveling on the way, you need three, two is not sufficient. Sayale, Moshim lo shnei talmid chachomi. A man had forewarned his wife not to sequester with another man. It's called Kinoi. She went and remained secluded with this man who she was warned not to. For a period of time she could have had relations, so she assumes the status of Sode. He's traveling to Yerushalayim because she claims she's innocent. He's agreeable that if it's verified she did not commit adultery, they're going to be together. So the Beis Din has two Talmid Chum accompanying them to Yerushalayim, because if he has relations with her prior to the drinking, the water is not going to work, it's not going to be effective. Not going to be effective, because the pasuk says Niko or Ishmi Avon. The husband has to be removed from sin. Has to be removed from sin. If he himself, who is not permitted to cohabit with her after, until it's verified, so he two have to be with him to make sure he doesn't cohabit with his wife. How many men do you have? You have the husband, and you have two tamid chachomim. Sayale, we have a proof from the Mishnah. Mosim l'shnei tamid chachomim, shem yovo le'abaderech. So what do we have? Trey, Viyu. You have two, and him, Hatlosa. Meaning, even if one should go off to the side to urinate, you have one person left together with the husband. So the husband won't cohabit because he have the other man, the other person there. So Mercer says, no, there's no proof in there. Hosam kihech nevi le sadi. Because factually, if he, let's say he goes and he violates this law, now they'll come to Yerushalayim, he'll present his wife, and watch, and it's not going to be who watch to drink, but it's not going to be effective. So they're going to obliterate the name of Hashem for no reason, because you're only permitted to obliterate it that it should be a verification process. But since he's not Nikomi Ovon, since he defiled her because he wasn't permitted, so therefore it's not. So therefore you have to two witnesses testify in Yerushalayim whether anything happened on the way up. So it's not because you need three on the way, because you need two people to testify. Well, it's interesting. No, Edechot's not believed. It's not believed. He has a cheskes. Husband has a cheskes kashrus. Right? He has cheskes now. It's interesting. The Gemara says, a psula, if a man marries a psula, she's married on a certain day. Right? She should be married on Wednesday. Why? Because, you know, in the old days, there was a hiatus of 12 months between the Kedushin, the Ersin, and the Nesuin. If let's say she would commit adultery during this period of time, so she's an adulteress, the husband's not permitted to her. So let's say Now, after the chuppah, he consummates the marriage. He finds out she's not a virgin. Now, it's not so simple. So what happened? What happened to her? How did she lose her virginity? Either she had an accident or she had relations. She committed adultery during this period of time. So why do we say she should be married on Wednesday? Because the Beis Din would convene Monday and Thursday. So he finds that she's not a virgin. He's really upset. He's livid. Immediately, he'll come to Beis Din the next morning. What happens if he has to wait a few days? If you allow any degree of lapse of time, he cools down. Cools down. Once he cools down, and he may not go to Beis Din. If he doesn't go to Beis Din, what happens? He's going to be living in sin for the rest of his life with the woman, unless he divorces her sometime in the future. So to prevent this possibility, we say a virgin is married on Wednesday. So if in fact he finds this a problem, immediately the next morning, when he's upset, he's immediately come to Beis Din. Mishnah, first Mishnah in Sukkos. Okay? We ask the question, if the man is only going to Yerushalayim with his wife to make this determination, whether she committed adultery, because the only way to verify it, what went on behind closed doors with the Meisota, so it says, what do you need, two Talmidei Chachamim, to testify that if he did have relations, they're not going to obliterate the name of Hashem, because he's not qualified for the process. But he's only going to make this determination. So if he's only going to make this determination, so what's the point, right? What do you need people? It's an exercise in futility over here. What's the point? Right? The Torah says Nikli Shmi Yavon. He's not Nikli Shmi Yavon. If he's tainted with sin, it's not going to work. So what do you need to have? If you say to prevent him from having relations, it's on the way. You need three. Okay, so that's good. But if you say it's to testify, what do you need to testify? He himself is only going to verify she didn't commit adultery. The process is not considered viable any longer, right? So how do we understand a simple understanding of the Gemara? What? Exactly. Right. So how do we understand it? So I think it's the same thing. Well, initially he wanted to know. He still wants to know. But everything now is not the same as like when initially he defied his warning. What the Gemara says, we just started Sota today, without Yomi. Gemara says normally, no, Yosef started Sota. We got real serious. I don't know what I'm on up. So the Gemara says normally say, Ein Dam Shaver Pokes Mishnayim, right? If you want to change a person's status regarding whether they violated something, they committed adultery, a woman's married or divorced, to change their marital status, you have to have two witnesses. Ain't of Shabbat post Mishnah. Okay? So, but yet the halacha is that if a man forewarns his wife, the presence of two witnesses, not to be involved with a certain man, and then she defies his warning, the two witnesses testify, they went behind closed doors in seclusion, and they were there long enough something could have happened. She's not permitted until it's verified. But she's eligible to drink the Meisota, to undergo the ritual of the Sota. What happens if you have an Eid Echod who comes now and he claims that he was able to peer into the room and he saw them having relations? Do you believe in Eid Echod? Of course, now, right? But till now, she has a chance she could actually be vindicated. If he says, now do you believe it's a Dom Sheberva? But based on the pasuk indicates that he will be believed. Although he's an Eid Echod, even though it's a Dom Sheberva. So my answer is because there's Raglaim in the Dom. Since there's circumstantial evidence, very strong circumstantial evidence, something really did happen. So you just need a slight more degree of verification, therefore an Eid Echod is sufficient. Under normal ceremony, because it's a Cheskes Kashrus or whatever. Here there's a Cheskes Kashrus is really breached. It's very weak. Because here you have the circumstances, and a pretty strong circumstances, that something did happen. That's why I believe in Eid Echod. Wait a second. So Mar says, that's why Eid Echod's believed, because the Yesh Raglaim L'Dover. It's Gemara. Okay? So I'm saying over here, initially, she defied him. He's livid. He's upset. The time passes. Don't forget to Yerushalayim. He cools down. So now He has to live with his conscience. If he would want to continue with his wife, he has to feel he's not living in sin. You know something? She underwent the ritual. That's
enough.
It's enough. But it didn't, you see, she didn't die. But maybe it didn't die because it wasn't Nikah Yishmiyovo. He doesn't attribute it to that. Therefore, as a result of that, you have to have two Talmidei Chachomim to testify whether he did have relations with her or he didn't have relations with her. No, that the Gemara says no. That the Gemara says before. Because they have to forewarn him. Because they have to know the halacha. Right? They have to know the halacha. And two ordinary people, they don't know the halacha. You know, what the ramifications of that is. That's what has to be two Talmidei Chachomim. No, no. But, you know, how sure you always have to have Tochid Dibur. People have short memories. Right? No. Incorrect. What you say. We rule, I'm speaking, you have two on the forewarning, two on the seclusion. You're talking now the act of cohabitation. This is after that. Right? This is the third part of it. Okay? Rav Rabbi Yehuda, they were traveling on the way. Burcha, but we'll see. This was within the city. This is not out in the country. Havikazlai Itzo Kamayu. There was a woman who was walking towards them, or before them. Omar the Rav, the Rabbi Yehuda. Rav says to Rabbi Yehuda, his colleague, Dal Karet Mikamigehu. Let's remove our feet that we shouldn't be susceptible and liable for getting. Meaning, because we're in a position now, we're secluded with this woman, so we have to quickly pass her by to remove ourselves from her proximity. That's what Rav says to Rav Yehuda. Omalei v'omaru di'omar b'ksherim, Shabbatomi said earlier. That admission says two men are, Rav said earlier, two men are permitted to square cell with a woman. It's only b'ksherim. If there are people of moral integrity, but if they have no moral integrity, because Mar told them the story, that 10 men were with a woman and they all cohabit with her in the presence of one another. People, they have no scruples, no anything. But the Ksherim, so Rav and Rav Yehuda, the Ksherim, said the Ksherim, what is he concerned about? One person is not going to cohabit in the presence of the other. It's not, it doesn't mean that. It's the derech means you're traveling outside. This is within the proximity. Let's see. No. We said earlier. If you're baderech, if one goes to urinate, you have a problem. Right? So over here, we're not talking to baderech. If this would be baderech, there's no question. So Rabbi, this is still, they're within the tchum of a city. Right? They're not baderech. So it's sufficient. They're close enough to the city, there's no concern over here. So that's the Gemara's question. Omalei. So Rav Yehuda says to Rav. Rav Yehuda says to Rav, Miyemar, Dibksherim, Gon Anovaat. Right? I mean, the halacha is what? It doesn't apply to people who are classified as ksherim. People who are of moral integrity. So what's your concern? Eluk Gomai. I mean, if we're not ksherim, who is ksherim? Kigon Rav Chanina Bar Popi v'chaveirov. They were of another level. Rav Chanina Bar Popi and his colleagues, they would be classified as ksherim. You know, it's like somebody comes to somebody's house and, you know, it's not kosher enough. This is not kosher. What is kosher enough? There's a story many years ago, this is in the 40s, of Laser Silver was the rabbi in Cincinnati. And he was a super genius. And he was very involved in the war, the Bahad Solar, this and that. And he was visiting Baltimore. So he came to my Yeshiva's house. And he always traveled with his own food, ate by no one. Okay? That was his policy. He had a little, in those days, he didn't have to shake a little suitcase he carried. He would have his food that his wife prepared for him. So he comes to my Rosh Hashanah's house, and the Rebbetzin, she wants to offer him supper. He says, I'm sorry, I don't live in anybody's house. And he says, I have no own food. He said, what? He says, you know. He doesn't, you know. He's always concerned about the kashrus. There's a man, he was like 20, 30 years old about Rashidah, so what he didn't feel was a disrespect. So he's, and his wife was a real Litvish Rebbetzin, Rashidah's wife. She came from Slavutka, she was from the family. So he says to them, could I have a plate and some cutlery? He says, no, you don't trust my couches, I don't trust your couches. You know, if I'm not kosher enough for you, you're not kosher enough for me. That's the way it is. Okay, so this is before disposable. Okay. Wait a second, I just want to say, so Rav Yehuda says, so who is kosher enough? Who has this level? He says, Rav Chanina bar Poppi b'chaveiros. So all the Farshim say, it was a chumra. This was a chumra. This was Rav's personal chumra. Of course, Rav was a kosher. It's not even a question. Rav was a kosher. But he was concerned, you know. Also, you know, it's brought. The Gemara says sometimes for a person to put himself in a situation, because we're going to discuss in a moment, that if the door is open, who was a yichud on the floor? Of course, what door means, what is the door open? Is the door open? We could actually look from the outside into the room. Yeah. We're open. Yeah. You should go in the office. Or open means the door is not locked. What does open mean? The door is open. Not locked, well, means physically the door is open. Because then, the nevertheless decided that a person of status should not, even in that situation, why? Because people always have what they say. A person who was a person of a certain halachic caliber should not go there. Because people always have what to say. Okay? Yeah. Like we had a Gemara, the Gemara says in Abu Nazoro, regarding Bishalakum, that if something could be eaten raw, in the raw state, or it's not olal shulchan malochim, the laws of Bishalakum don't apply to that food item. So, okay, so that's the question. Let's say a non Jew cooks a pot of water or percolates coffee for you. Are you permitted to drink the coffee? That's permitted. Water is potable even if it's not cooked. And the coffee bean, even though coffee bean cannot be eaten raw, has to be roasted, has to be cooked. Nevertheless, so Tosis says, and everybody agrees to this, is because what is the determining factor which classifies it? It's the bracha. So since you say shako on coffee, so it identifies with the water. So since water has the realm of bishalakum, you're permitted. Bishalakum is not. You're permitted to drink the coffee or whatever it is, or at least it's about beer, which was cooked, it was hops or fruits, whatever way it was made, you could drink it. So Mar asked a question, but if it was a namora, he wouldn't drink it. As far as this other chashuv shalom, that a person of status, of halak status, is that he should be machmir. Because what do people say? Well, the rabbi, he drank bishalakum. What do people know? Do people know all the intricacies of what bishalakum not? Let it be machmir. Because people always could draw from that to themselves. So the same thing, even in a situation where it would not be considered yichud, where the door is open, let's say the door is closed and it's not locked. So halakhali, it's not yichud. What people can say, you want to a woman, you want closed doors, it's a problem. You know, people always have what to say. But okay. Firstly, the Gemara says, you know, we just had this. That when a person does his function, you have to do it in a state of modesty. For somebody else to be able to, even from a distance, see your male organ, it's not sufficiently modesty. That means he has to go far away. In that amount of time, you never know what could happen. You never know what could happen. Therefore, that's the reason why we choose Rabbi Yehuda. First, it's interesting. Today, you know, Rashi says we had earlier, what's considered an act of cohabitation? Is it full penetration? Or it's just the male organ touching the woman in a private place? Or partial entry? One opinion is even touching. Other one says partial entry. Partial. That's considered an act of cohabitation. That's the amount of time the person has to sequester himself behind closed doors. That could take a moment, literally a moment. See, the person doesn't have to do the full act of intercourse. Doesn't have to complete it. That's sufficient. Of course, that's already, that's considered an act of adultery. That's called harov. Okay? Omer Rav Chanina Malkan al Yichud. Veinosin al Yichud. Okay? You have a married woman. She spends a night in a hotel room with another man. Let's say she wasn't forewarned. She wasn't forewarned. And she permitted her husband. She's permitted to her husband. Can you imagine? She's halachically, she's permitted to her husband. The only time a woman becomes a suspected adulteress is only if she defied his warning. But if she was never forewarned, although she spent a night in a hotel room, a week in a hotel room, okay? The halacha is she's permitted to her husband. She still retains a cheskes kashrus, but nevertheless, inappropriate behavior. So you give a malchus. Malchus means not Torah malchus. Malchus marus. Right? You give her watch. It's caning. The difference between malchus, the rice malchus drabonon, is either with a, one's with a whip, with a strap, the other one's with a cane. The person's cane. Okay, the makir. She was miyachin, malkin al yichud. In other words, how do you know? What he says means nothing. Right? The husband's made effort, it's a korach, whatever he's not believing. Omer avashi lo amor el yichud penuyah. That we go and we rein in her, she gets lashes, that's only if she's a single woman. It's not a question of adultery. Al yichud eishes ish lo. But if it's a married woman, acted inappropriately, we don't give a malchus. Why? Shlotei motzi lazo bonel. Because let's say she has children. What are people going to say? They're not her children. Who knows whose kids they are? If she's a single woman, so good, she had an illicit relationship. That's what people would say. I mean, she'll be permitted to a kohen, right? She'd be permitted to a kohen. Because if we have no evidence that they actually had relations, she has a cheskes kashrus. But factually, she wasn't permitted. You give a malchus. But a married woman, you're not going to give a malchus, because one people are going to say, why is the bezdin giving a malchus? She committed adultery. So if she committed adultery, they're going to say, it's her children and not her children. It should be motzi lazo boneo. So it's interesting, because our author, you know, when you write a Sefer Torah, Tzimun Mezuzah, you have tagim. You have crowns on certain letters called Shatman's Gats. Those are the letters. Shatman's Gats. Okay? Now the question is, when a person writes a get for his wife, the person has to divorce his wife, the sofer, and he commissions the sofer, is the sofer permitted to put tagim in the get? Is he permitted? What? What's wrong with it? It's what? No. If a sofer, you know, he has his hallmark when he writes. You know, it's a piece of art. What's the target to get? Is he going to be allowed? Okay, that's the question. Okay, I'm going to tell you why you shouldn't do it. Okay. She has to receive the gift. No. So the Gemara says, Okay? The Gemara says in Gittin, let's say you have one sofer writing with Tagim, another sofer writer doesn't write with Tagim. Do you know what people are going to say? The get without Tagim is not a valid get. That means she's not really divorced. So if she remarried, what are people going to say about her children? They're going to say to Mamzerim. So Shalolahotzi Laza Bonel, people are going to say it wasn't a valid divorce. Because it wasn't a valid document, it wasn't written properly. It had to have the tagim. Therefore, we don't allow tagim in any get. Because this eventuality, this action could happen. You know, people speak. Shalolahotzi Laza Bonel, therefore no get. A get has tagim, it's not a valid get for that reason. not giving exactly, I'm just giving the compare what we're talking about here. What is Rav Ashi says, and Malkin al Yichud, if she's a married woman, because people are going to make certain conclusions that something happened, and people are going to say the kids, the children are not a kid, are not a children, and Mamzer, they're illegitimate. Marzutra Malki Machus. Marzutra, he would give Malkus even to the married woman, and he would make an announcement that the reason why she's receiving Malkus is not because she committed adultery, but rather for inappropriate behavior. So this would become public knowledge. So the concern of Shalotzi Lazo Boneh is not a concern. People are not going to attribute it to an act of adultery. Witness, definitely. Right, that's all the expression. No, then she's an adulteress. She's suspected, but we treat her as an adulteress until it's verified. And there's no way to verify it. Correct.
But what do you think that a married woman knows instinctively that if she is secluded with a man, even without warning, it's not kosher?
So her behavior is not kosher, therefore what? She did something she shouldn't have done. So what do we do to her? To teach her a lesson. Do you give a malchus, don't you give a malchus? Rav Ashi says no, because people are going to draw a conclusion which is not a good thing. They're going to actually say her children are not her children, which is not true. There's no basis. Because if she has a cheskes kashrus, her children are kosher children. Marriage continues. If the husband wants to continue with the marriage continues.
Doesn't matter. So there's no test. She did it.
Who knows it? Only God knows. No, they and God knows. He wouldn't. Because he has a right to rely on chazaka. And the person eats meat. And later it's found out the animal was a defective animal. And he had a right to rely on, he drank milk. He relied on rope. Majority of animals are not defective. They slaughter them, they find out the animal is a traitor. He needs to do something wrong. When he drank the milk, he had a right to rely on rope. Halachically, if he'd go to the bezin, he would ask, is she permitted to be in that bezin? She's permitted. Because Chazaka says she's permitted. God knows differently, and she knows differently. It's irrelevant. He's not faulted at all. Because he has a right to rely on Chazaka. But she has a cheskes kashrus. Did the husband have relations with her in the interim?
And the husband says, I didn't have relations
with her. Okay. So the husband's not permitted to her.
And the children are mundane.
No. Okay. You know, the room wasn't built in a day. Okay. We'll talk about it. Let's try to focus on the Gemara over here. Okay? It's what's his name? That's the other. No, she's not believed. Because Shem and Osei near Ba'achir. The Gemara noted. It's the Gemara at the very end in the door. Make a scene today on Osei. It's the end in the door. Okay? No argument. Everybody agrees she's committed. There's no argument.
The reason.
Yeah.
The reason is for her. So would you say that this act of seclusion is sufficient
to breach that chazaka? Correct. But no. The Gemara says it's only circumstantial evidence, sufficient circumstantial, if she defied his warning and secluded herself. But if it's one without the other, it's not sufficient. But that's what the Torah says. The Torah. The Torah is based on psukim. The Torah says, when does she assume the status, the suspected doses as a sota? Only if you had A and B. Forewarned, and she defies his warning by the seclusion. So what's the inference of that? If the first was lacking, she's permitted to him. How could you be permitted to him? It's minimally a sofik. The chazoka is weakened. It's evidently the Torah is saying no. The chazoka is sufficient to allow the man to continue having relations with his wife. No, the one aid, not to convict her, to confirm that she committed adultery. Because it was after Kenny and Stero. It was after the full warning and after the seclusion. No. It's this is more than just, this is exceptional circumstantial evidence. Let's say they did acts of intimacy, but not the actual act of intercourse. She's permitted the husband. I'm not saying, you know, she's considered a corrupted person in terms of what her values are, but is she permitted? The only way a woman becomes forbidden is only if there's intercourse. If there's no cohabitation, regardless of whatever else they did, it's irrelevant. She's not an adulteress. The Gemara says, today a person should not fool one his wife. Gets upset, I don't want you to see him with him. Let's say now she does. Today, because we don't have to make sota, he has to divorce her. So the person has to be careful what he says to his wife. No, doesn't make a difference. No. I told you to stay away from him. It seems to me there's no. No, specific person. Yes, specific. No, witnesses say nothing. This is not a question of punishment. This is testifying to fact. Factually, she secluded herself. No. It's none of their business. It's none of their business. Exactly. Exactly. Okay. Marzucher Malki Machris. So how did Marzucher address this issue? Not to be Motzi Laz on the children. When he would give the married woman Malkos, he would announce to the community the reason why she's getting Malkos is not because she committed adultery, but because her behavior is unacceptable behavior. And people can draw a worse conclusion. People can draw a worse conclusion. Amalei Rav Nachman Mifar Hachil Rav Ashi. So Rav Nachman, who came from many people call Rav Nachman, Maranami Lilki Vilichris, he says, Rav Ashi says, why didn't he give Malkos? Because he was concerned it would actually cause the children to be seen as illegitimate. So he says to Rav, so why don't you do the same thing as Matrucha? Give him Malkos, and but before you give the Malkos, announce to the community that this is not because of adultery. Amalei, you know what my concern is? Ika deshama bavel deshama vo. What happens if people become aware that she received Malkos, but they never heard that there was an announcement? So if that's the case, what those people, that particular segment of the people, they say the kids are illegitimate. So therefore, not to get involved in this problem, we don't give Malkos. It's not worthwhile to give the Malkos. That's what Rav Ashi did. He didn't conduct himself as Marzucha. Well, we rule like Rav Ashi. We rule like Rav Ashi. We have a minute. No? Okay. Omer Av, Malkin al-Lotuv HaShemur. Let's say there was a persistent rumor that a man was not behaving properly. Right? No evidence. Not that we have witnesses. We have witnesses. It's more than Lotuv HaShemur. It's more than, you know, it seems he's doing the wrong thing. So you give a person Malkos. Shenemar, Albonai Kilo Tuvashmur. Eli had two sons, named Hophni and Pinchas. They were Kohanim. And the women, hold up the women, the woman after she gives birth, she has to bring the korban. They had the pretty time, they held up the women. So the women that would come to Mishneh Shiloh to bring the korbanos. And then they would delay them so till they returned to the husbands, so they couldn't cohabit with their husbands. So Eli says to his children, you're doing the wrong thing. Al Bonai, my children, you're doing, my sons, you're doing the wrong thing. Ki lo tov, words getting out. And the Gemara says, it's committed equivalent to, as if they committed adultery with them. Not that they did. But denying a woman to her husband, it's considered something serious. So because this is an unnecessary delay, just because of their arrogance, he said to his sons, your behavior is unacceptable. So that means word gets out, lo tov ha-shmur. So lo tov ha-shmur, it says al. Al is always a negative commandment. So therefore, you give malchus, if there is such a rumor, a person's behaving in a way where they speak badly about a person, that he's a transgressor, he deserves malchus.